Guernica, a town in northern Spain, was important to the culture of the Basques that lived in that region. In its center stood an ancient oak tree, under which the people gathered to meet and elect their leaders. On April the 26th, 1937, the name of the town was written into the pages of the history of warfare forever. It was the first town to be destroyed completely by aerial bombardment. At 4:30 in the afternoon, the main church bell rang to warn of the coming of an air attack. It was market day, and in spite of the civil war raging around the town, farmers had still come in with their sheep and cattle. Upon hearing the bells, they joined the refugees from the battles around the town and went down into the cellars. A single Heinkel 111 bomber of the German Condor Legion's experimental squadron flew over the town, dropped its load on the center, and then disappeared. Most people came out of their shelters believing the attack was over and went to help the injured. 15 minutes later, the full squadron flew over. They began dropping various sizes of bombs. People rushed back into the cellars choking on the smoke and dust. It was clear that the shelters could not withstand the heavier bombs, and a stampede into the fields around the town began. Then, the Heinkel 51 fighter squadron swept over, strafing the men, women, and children. Livestock, and even the nuns from the town's hospital were caught up in this. The major part of the attack had not even started. At 5:15, the sound of heavier aero engines were heard. These were identified as the ponderous Junkers 52. Three squadrons from Burgos carpet-bombed the town systematically, 20-minute relays for 2.5 hours. Their loads were made up of a variety of bombs. The incendiaries were sprinkled down from the Junkers in 2-pound aluminium tubes like metallic confetti. The resulting scene was described in terms of hell and the apocalypse.
The attack on Guernica was completely unexpected for two main reasons. Firstly, the Republican forces had been preparing the Condor Legion in secret, and therefore the people on the ground hadn't expected to be attacked. But more importantly, they felt that they were protected by the Washington Accord, which actually forbade aerial attacks against civilian targets. And it was a great exercise in cynicism, whereby the Germans were able to achieve this political sleight of hand and actually disguise their own national forces as some kind of mercenary outfit known as the Condor Legion, which in practice they never were. So it was a very cynical attack, and unfortunately it was a forerunner of what was to come in World War II.
Whole families were buried in the ruins of their houses. Cattle and sheep, blazing with thermite and white phosphorus, ran crazily between the burning buildings until they died. Approximately a third of the town's population were casualties. 1,654 killed and 889 wounded. Condor Legion veterans were later to claim that their squadrons were really trying to bomb the Renteria Bridge nearby, but that strong winds blew their loads onto the town. The bridge was never hit. There was virtually no wind. The anti-personnel bombs, incendiaries, and machine guns used by the Junkers are not effective against stone bridges. Those hurrying towards the town from Bilbao had their original disbelief at the news changed by the sight of the orange-red glow in the sky. When they reached the town, they found the Parliament buildings and the oak tree untouched. The rest of Guernica was a burnt skeleton.
The architect of the attack on Guernica, who was also the architect of the Luftwaffe, was Hermann Göring. Göring had been a fighter pilot during the Great War and fought with great distinction in the Richthofen squadron. But between 1933 and 1945, he evolved into a kind of mixture between a gangster and a warlord. He ran the Luftwaffe as his own fiefdom. He was vain, selfish, arrogant, greedy, childish. Almost every unfavourable adjective you can think of can be applied to Göring. He was so vain that he had his own uniforms tailored to his own design. He amassed enormous personal wealth by stealing from the countries that Germany had occupied.
The same tactic that was used on Guernica was used against the Polish city of Warsaw when Germany began its push into Poland on September the 1st, 1939. From the first attack, the Polish capital was battered by German bombers. Very soon it was surrounded by the ground forces. It stood defiant with enemies all around. The task of breaking the will of this stronghold was given to the Luftwaffe.
At the beginning of the war, both sides did not specifically go out to attack civilian populations. This was for two reasons. One, they didn't have much in the way of bombers to attack civilian populations effectively, and two, they were afraid of retaliation from the other side. But even in 1941, you can see that while they attack military targets, a lot of bombs miss, hit civilian populations. Each side is convinced that the other did that on purpose, so there is a mounting willingness to attack civilian populations. It's also the case that in the interwar period, the theorists of air power had realized, or supposed anyway, that attack upon civilian population would result in a great destruction of civilian morale, and thus of loss of fighting efficiency. So the civilians were always liable to be there as a target.
For 27 days, the planes came again and again to smash the heart out of the once proud medieval city. This was another mass bombing of a civilian target. This was blitzkrieg in its awful majesty. This was the Luftwaffe at its most devastating, fulfilling the role it had been designed to meet. As the war went on and Germany continued to confront its enemies on front after front, again and again the Luftwaffe was asked to fulfill the role of tactical bombing. In Norway and then in the push through Holland and Belgium and on into France, the Junkers Ju-87B or Stuka, Dornier Do-17 and Heinkel He-111 operated in their close support role to the advancing ground forces. Only after the fall of France did the shortcomings of an air force designed to support this tactic become apparent.
It was always intended to support, first and foremost, the needs of the army on the ground. It was never really envisaged as having a long-range strategic role. One of the reasons for that is that the Luftwaffe was almost entirely officered by people who came from the army. There were very few true flyers in there, such as you would recognise in the RAF. One of the main reasons for that, obviously, is that under the Treaty of Versailles, for a long time, there was no such thing as a German Air Force. So they didn't have the same separate agenda and separate esprit de corps that you would find, for example, in the United States Air Force or the British RAF.
Germany now faced Britain. It was an enemy where the swift blitzkrieg attack was not immediately possible. The planned invasion could not go ahead until the Luftwaffe held the skies over southern England and the English Channel. The Battle of Britain was begun. At its height, the same aircraft that had been used to bomb Poland, Norway, and the rest into submission were having considerable success in weakening the British fighters and their bases. It looked like it would be only a matter of time before the might of the German army would once more be advancing under its familiar air umbrella. Then, in September 1940, the nature of the air campaign changed. The orders went out from the highest level that instead of the airfields, London must be bombed. This was the way that Britain would be brought to surrender. A new type of blitz had begun.
The Luftwaffe stopped the bombing of the airfields because they thought they had virtually achieved their purpose, that the airfields were almost unusable and that they had destroyed most of the strength of fighter command by this tactic. It would therefore be reasonable to try to destroy the remaining strength of fighter command by attacking a different target. It's also the sort of target that appealed to people like Goering and to Hitler to strike savagely in daylight at a big city, partly aiming at legitimate military targets like the docks, but also aiming to spread terror and fear amongst the population.
Now the German bombers rained down their loads on another ancient capital. Bombs fell on dockyards and palaces alike. Fires raged in all parts of the city, in the poorest east and the fashionable west. But it was not enough. For once, the bombers of the Luftwaffe were found wanting. Designed for a close support role, they were ill-equipped for the task of strategic bombing that had been thrust upon them.
It was very difficult to put enough defensive firepower on a medium bomber to give it good defensive capacity because of its relatively small size. These planes also could not carry much in the way of armour to protect the engines, pilots, and so forth. And they also did not carry a very heavy bomb load, so they were not terribly satisfactory aircraft.
Night and day saw plane after plane failing to reach its target, falling prey to fighter and ground-based attack. From the success of the Blitzkrieg as seen in the destruction of Warsaw, the planes of the Luftwaffe were facing defeat in the skies over Britain. It was in the 1930s when the first stages for what would be the largest war the world had ever seen were first implemented. The German High Command felt that total victory could be achieved in a few short years. Their strategy would see Central Europe fall piece by piece in a series of deep offensives. Air power was seen as a vital component of this, for battle, transport and supply, as well as providing the essential offensive support. The Treaty of Versailles that had ended World War I disbanded the German Air Force. The Germans were banned from producing military aircraft and prohibited from subsidizing the manufacture of civil aircraft. Initially, the German aircraft designers were forced to seek work abroad, although when the restrictions of non-military craft was lifted in 1926, they were able to return. Germany then began to plan for war by designing aircraft seemingly for peaceful purposes, such as airliners or airmail carriers that could be adapted for military use. The Third Reich was to discover that the needs of a commercial aircraft are very different to the needs of an effective warplane or transport. The Luftwaffe rotated around one man, Hermann Göring. History was to show that he was too interested in his own success to stand firm against the inaccurate ratings of the Führer.
He was boastful, he told lies, he was a fantasist. He really is one of the strangest characters to grace the pages of history. He must have been a huge opportunist, because although he was fairly brave as a fighter pilot, which no one denies, he seems to have gone personally and politically out of control. He saw himself as Hitler's successor, and in the last years of the war mounted a forlorn attempt to replace Hitler. And he did manage, as history tells us, to cheat death, to cheat the hangman's noose after the trial at Nuremberg, when somehow he alone managed to smuggle in some cyanide into his cell. So he is the most bizarre character you come across in the pages of history. It's almost inconceivable that such a man, with so many obvious and glaring faults, could not only rise to that position, but to hold that position throughout the entire war, when he made a series of disastrous lapses of judgment and terrible mistakes, almost from day one of the war, right through to the end.
However, the Luftwaffe in its conception was a highly trained, well-equipped strike force. All that was left was to blood the pilots and test the tactics. The opportunity was taken in 1936 with the outbreak of the Civil War in Spain. Hitler immediately provided 20 Ju-52s and a fighter escort of 6 HE-51s to convoy 10,000 Moorish soldiers from North Africa to Spain for General Franco. In November 1936, the first German pilots of the so-called Volunteer Condor Legion arrived in Spain. In the next 2 years, Germany cynically rotated thousands of her aircrew and dozens of aircraft types in service with the Condor, to distribute battle experience as widely as possible. By May 1937, the Condor was operating 200 aircraft, including 50 Ju-52s in a bomber role, up to 50 fighters, and various ground attack and reconnaissance types. Later, the Messerschmitt Bf 109B fighter and the new HE-111 bomber were tested. There was never a shortage of volunteers from the Luftwaffe to serve in Spain. They received extra pay and a step up in rank for serving with the Condor. The Germans perfected their ground attack techniques in this campaign, often turning around their aircraft so fast that each completed 6 or 7 sorties in a day. But they also made some serious errors. They muddled through the war with scarcely any provisions for ground-to-air or air-to-air radio communications.
It was a considerable disadvantage, of course, but it should be remembered that the Germans had a very good ground radar system, at least as good as the British had, and that this system could be used to coach German fighters onto Allied bomber formations, whether by day or by night.
No effort was made to improve this equipment until after 1940. They also found that their Do-17 and HE-111 bombers were faster than the Republicans' biplane fighters, and rashly regarded this as proof of the effectiveness of the self-supporting bomber formation. This view was reinforced by a visit to RAF Hornchurch by senior German air officers Erhard Milch and Ernst Uder. Here they found this British fighter squadron to be equipped with Gloster Gladiator biplanes, which could also be outpaced by the Heinkels and Dorniers. These observations were to lead to even greater overconfidence.
Milch and Udet were certainly misled by their brief visit to Britain, when famously they were taken to visit a squadron of Gloster Gladiator fighters, which were old biplanes, and they formed the impression that the entire RAF used aircraft which were as antiquated as that. It's very fortunate for us indeed that that happened, because at the time there were relatively few Spitfires and few Hurricanes. They were only beginning to come into service in 1936. And it's a great mercy that the Germans formed that view at that particular time. Otherwise, the outcome of the Battle of Britain could have been very different if Germany had concentrated on better fighters with a longer range than the Messerschmitt 109.
The opportunity taken in the Spanish Civil War was to hold the Luftwaffe in good stead when the war began in earnest with the attacks on Poland, Norway, and France. In the atmosphere of blitzkrieg, the expected quick victory had no need for strategic or long-range bombers.
Hitler was reluctant to put much in the way of resources into long-range bombers for a number of reasons. One is that the Luftwaffe was developed primarily to assist the army. So you wanted fighters, dive bombers, and short-range bombers in order to meet that purpose. He also expected to fight reasonably short wars. This was a theory behind the Blitzkrieg idea: fight a short war and get it over quickly. And long-range bombing tends to have its effect over a considerable period of time. And so for that reason too, there would be a reluctance to develop long-range bombers. But the principal reason, perhaps, in 1936, perhaps was a technical one. In 1936-37, which is when the Germans would have to be beginning development of these bombers to have them useful in the war, because it's a lead development time of 6 or 7 years, in 1936-37, the Germans didn't have engines powerful enough to drive a big four-engine bomber with a heavy bomb load and a great height. They tried, but the results were not impressive.
The speed of expected advance meant that every new design proposed was first assessed on its ability to be turned into a dive bomber.
The Luftwaffe was certainly obsessed by the use of dive bombers, and the reason is an interesting one. The man in charge of technical development, Ernst Udet, paid a visit to America around 1930. Now, at this time, the American Navy was experimenting with dive bombers because it had found that horizontal bombers flying level at 10,000 feet could not possibly hit warships that were maneuvering below. They worked out that the only chance they had of hitting these ships with bombs was by dive bombing. You go down from 10,000 feet, release your bombs at about 2,000 or 3,000 feet, you have something like 20 or 30 seconds to zero in on the target, and if the target moves, you can move with it too. And they found that dive bombing was at least 10 times as accurate as the horizontal bombing of the time. Udet was greatly impressed with this, bought some dive bombers from the Americans and took them back to America, and when he became technical director, laid down this directive that dive bombing was the way to attack. And most certainly it is in terms of accuracy.
It was sheer lunacy to try and adapt these huge aircraft to be used in a dive bombing role, because by definition, dive bombing is about precision. It's about being able to dive almost onto the target and lay your bomb with pinpoint accuracy. Big aircraft are used for area bombing against area targets, and for that reason they don't need to be so accurate as a dive bomber does. So the whole thing was nonsensical and futile.
The main thrust of new aircraft design had to be towards the short and medium range bomber to operate in support of the ground forces. Pride of place to this type of attack aircraft must go to the Junkers Ju-87B. This was to be known as the Stuka dive bomber. However, this aircraft was to be ably supported by others. The Dornier DO-17 was also in service at this time. This was nicknamed the Flying Pencil because of the narrow fuselage section. Originally designed as a fast passenger airliner, but made so slim that it was unacceptable for fare-paying customers. By chance, flown by an Air Ministry official in 1934, who was so impressed that he suggested it could form the basis for a bomber. It was to form the basis of the tactical bomber strength in the late 1930s. By the end of 1935, three large factories were devoted to producing this aircraft. In 1938, Dornier produced a new, almost whimsical nose design to hold four crew with a gun firing below towards the rear. This was to lead to the main wartime model, the Z and the 215. Because of the increased weight of the aircraft, the 17Z was initially underpowered, and the full bomb load had to wait until the Fafnir 323P engines replaced the earlier Bramo radials. Although technically obsolescent by 1939, about a quarter of the German bomber and reconnaissance units deployed in the Battle of Britain were equipped with this aircraft. Unarmored and underpowered, it was highly vulnerable to fighter attack and carried a poor bomb load. Its chief merits, in the eyes of its crews, were strength, stability, and reliability. It was the most popular and reliable of Luftwaffe bombers at that time. Another aircraft designed originally for commercial purposes in service at the start of the war was the Focke-Wulf FW-200 Condor. This had been planned solely as a long-range commercial transport for the German airline Deutsche Lufthansa. The pre-war FW-200 prototype set up impressive record flights to New York and Tokyo. Transport prototype and production versions were also used by Hitler and Himmler as VIP executive machines. In 1938, the Japanese asked for one to be converted for use as a long-range ocean reconnaissance machine, which was to provide the Luftwaffe an aircraft which had never been requested. This was to prove a most powerful weapon of war. It was used operationally from June 1940. By September 1940, these planes had sunk over 90,000 tons of Allied shipping, and for the next 3 years, to quote Churchill, were the scourge of the Atlantic.
Churchill was right to be threatened by the Focke-Wulf Condor, and it's a really interesting example of where Germany could have taken a four-engine design. The Condor was a magnificent aircraft. It had a long range and it was able to carry a fairly heavy bomb load. Had that aircraft been taken and developed as a four-engine bomber, who knows what Germany might have been able to achieve.
As the FW-200 family continued to add new equipment, making it into an even more lethal aircraft, the Allies fought back. The use of long-range coastal command aircraft, aircraft carriers to escort convoys, and fitting catapult-launched fighters onto merchant ships effectively countered the attacks. By mid-1940, the surviving Condors had been forced into a transport role on other fronts. One of the fundamental failings of the Condor was structural weakness, catastrophic wing and fuselage failures occurring not only in the air, but even on the ground, on takeoff or landing. The Heinkel HE-111 was a graceful machine with elliptical wings and tail. It was secretly flown as a bomber in 1935, but revealed to the world a year later as a civil airliner. Operations began in February 1937, with the Condor Legion in Spain, where they had considerable success. Powered by 660 horsepower BMW 6 engines, It had a typical armament of 3 manually armed machine guns. The useful bomb load of 2,200 pounds was stowed nose up in 8 cells in the center fuselage. In 1937, a number of generally similar machines secretly flew photo reconnaissance missions over Britain, France, and the Soviet Union in the guise of airliners of Deutsche Lufthansa. At the same time, flight performance was being improved by the fitting of Daimler-Benz DB600 CG engines, producing 950 horsepower, replacing the earlier DB600C engines and their 880 horsepower. To a considerable degree, this misled the Luftwaffe into considering that nothing could withstand the onslaught of their huge fleets of medium bombers. They were faster than the single-seat fighters of that era and, so the argument went, therefore did not need much defensive armament. So the 3 machine guns carried by the first HE-111 bombers remained unchanged until they were hacked down with ease during the Battle of Britain. Its only defense was the structural strength and its ability to come back after being shot to pieces.
The main drawback of the Heinkel 111 as a bomber was in its lack of defensive armament. There was only one solitary machine gun pointing forwards, and most of the defensive arrangement was towards the rear arc of the aircraft. So it wasn't long before the RAF discovered a weakness like that, and with the inability of the German fighters to stay over England for very long, they had a field day destroying the 111. Despite that, Göring continued to persevere with that aircraft as the mainstay of the German bomber forces right through the whole 4 years of the war. There were a few attempts to upgrade the armament. It was given twin machine guns in the nose, for example, but they were very few and far between in comparison to the enormous dangers that it posed to the crews as both British and American and finally Russian fighters came up to scratch and they were able to knock them from the skies in huge numbers.
The inevitable result was that more and more defensive guns were added, needing a fifth or even a sixth crew member. Coupled with incessant growth in equipment and armor, the result was deteriorating performance, so that the record breaker of 1936 to 38 became the lumbering sitting duck of 1942 to 45. Yet the HE-111 was built in even greater numbers. Variations were legion, including versions with V1 tucked under the left wing root and a saboteur transport. The most extraordinary was the HE-111Z glider tug of 1942, which consisted of 2 HE-111H6s joined by a common center wing carrying a fifth engine. This model was designed as a tow aircraft for giant gliders. One of these was the Messerschmitt 321. This entered service in the Russian front in late 1941. The complex towing arrangements restricted its use to primarily rear area logistical operations. Another giant glider, the ME-323, had originally been designed for use in the invasion of the Benelux countries. Made of a plywood or fabric skin fitted over the welded steel tubular frame, it was extremely tiring to fly. This was due to the large control forces involved when loaded with its payload of 48,500 pounds, or complete company of infantry. It was so heavy that takeoff had to be boosted by rocket motors fitted under the wings. Originally towed by a complex arrangement of BF-110s in formation, it was later to be another glider towed by the HE-111Z. Despite these innovations, the Luftwaffe was dependent on older designs. Right to the end of the war, the German industry failed to find a replacement for the HE-111 as a close support bomber. At least 6,086 were produced. Production even continued after the war in Spain until 1956. Records show that by September 1939, Germany had built up an air force of some 9,220 aircraft. Of these, 4,530 were bombers. To face them, Britain had 928 fighters. The reorganization of the aircraft manufacturing plants during the early war years did a little to redress the balance. In August 1940, at the start of the Battle of Britain, the number of German bombers available was 1,112. Amongst them, there was not a single four-engine bomber. This restriction came from the Führer direct. He felt that an aircraft with four engines was less useful than two aircraft with two engines. This guided German aircraft in an unusual direction. The aim was always to get as many aircraft into the air as possible. Hitler believed that mighty flights of aircraft passing overhead would surely raise the morale of his forces that saw them and push them on to victory. The tactical changes forced upon Germany by the events of the summer of 1940 showed up the shortcomings of this view. The German bombers were at best medium range, medium strength, and of low defensive capability. They had been shoehorned into their new roles from the original designs until new designs could be manufactured. They were stretched to the very limit of their endurance as they rained down a deadly torrent of explosives on their chosen targets in London. Here they were met with a revitalized defense from the planes of British Fighter Command and were forced to abandon daylight raids and the invasion of Britain that was to have followed. Having failed to bring Britain to its knees, the German army turned its attention elsewhere. Other countries were to become the target for the Blitzkrieg machine. Attacks were made in the Balkans. Then, on the 21st of June 1941, a major push into Russian territory began. The tactical bombing by close air support once more yielded good results. The German armies were moving forward again, pursuing a retreating army, and the Luftwaffe was fulfilling its designed role. All this was about to change.
The Russian war was Hitler's greatest gamble and also the most flawed campaign that he embarked upon in his career. The generals were absolutely opposed to this foray into Russia, and it was here that the real failings of the Luftwaffe were most exposed. They had insufficient aircraft, they had the wrong type of aircraft, and they were completely unsuited to the climatic conditions that they were going to face throughout the Russian war. There were a few successes. The Focke-Wulf Yoo-Hoo or the Owl was a good reconnaissance aircraft, but by and large the aircraft were totally unsuited to the job. They were insufficiently prepared for the Russian campaign. The logistics were a nightmare. The winters were stronger and fiercer than anyone could have imagined. And by 1941, a lot of the aircraft were coming to the end of their service life. So there was a great extra strain on spares and repairs, which had to be brought all the way from Germany. So the Luftwaffe started the campaign at a disadvantage and then decreased in effectiveness.
When faced with the swiftly advancing enemy, Russia fell back on its well-tried defense. The country was placed on a war footing that used the size of the country as an ally. By destroying all facilities and communications in front of an advancing enemy, they forced the Germans to be dependent on ever-lengthening supply lines. These were vulnerable to counterattacks that were launched from deep inside Russian territory. The Russians moved their own manufacturing base to the region of the Urals far to the east. The medium-range German bombers could not fly this far. In spite of the time this took, once established, the Russians gained significant successes in slowing and finally defeating the German advance. The summer of 1943, during the Kursk offensive, saw the last attempt to secure air superiority over a major battlefield. The Germans had amassed 1,700 warplanes for the battle. Initially, this force achieved a number of notable successes, but was then checked and finally driven from the skies. The Russians had used their remote industries to produce increasingly capable warplanes flown by better-trained crews. The tactical bombing of Blitzkrieg was not designed to meet such a challenge. The Luftwaffe could not strike at an enemy whose war machine was located far behind the front line. Germany lacked the means to strike back. It lacked an effective long-range bomber. Despite the Luftwaffe's best efforts, they had been forced to concentrate on the shorter-range aircraft. One long-range design considered was the Junkers Ju-86. As with the HE-111, it was originally planned as both civil airliner and a bomber. In 1934, it was one of the most advanced aircraft in Europe. The design team abandoned corrugated skin and created a smooth and efficient machine with prominent double wing flaps and outward retracting main gears. This aircraft was the standard heavy bomber, but in Spain, it proved vulnerable even to biplane fighters. Faster versions, Series E with powerful BMW radials and the Swedish Bristol-engined K-Series, were produced and used against Poland. But that was their swan song. Resources were diverted to other projects. Later versions, the P-1 bomber and P-2 bomber reconnaissance aircraft, each fitted with a pressure cabin, were developed for high-altitude operations. They did see some service over Russia and Britain, where they could operate out of the range of all but the most determined fighters. The R series that followed had an even longer wingspan and frequently operated over southern England in 1941-42. These operations were curtailed when solitary Spitfires managed to reach their altitude and effect an interception. Most of these projects had been long abandoned before the fateful Russian campaign. Other new projects were developed to take their place. The desperation induced by the requirements of the Eastern Front led to the usual German response of re-engineering existing designs. Gliders were given engines. The ME-323 was fitted with 6 engines in an attempt to make it more effective. The resulting aircraft had the capability to deliver bulky loads to airfields virtually in the front line. Unfortunately, this was at the price of a catastrophic vulnerability to fighter attacks.
There were two main effects from the lack of heavy German aircraft during the Russian war. The first and most obvious is their inability to reach out and to damage the Russian war effort. They couldn't get to the other side of the Urals, they didn't have bombers that were heavy enough. So Russia was able to gear up its industry, to move it back behind the Urals, and almost without interruption to continue to produce the materials of war, particularly tanks, in huge numbers. That was one major failing for the Luftwaffe. The other was Göring's boastfulness when he persuaded Hitler that he and his Luftwaffe were capable of supplying the surrounded 6th Army at Stalingrad. Once again, this is a prime example of Göring's many failings and his boastfulness. He assured Hitler categorically that the 6th Army could be supplied from the air. And when the time came to break out, the 6th Army was too weak. The relief army was only 30 miles away, but the inability of the Luftwaffe to take through sufficient supplies, particularly fuel, meant that Paulus, in charge of 6th Army, didn't feel that he had enough strength to attempt to push a corridor through to the relieving force. If Göring had even been able to maintain half the level of supplies that he promised he could deliver, there was a possibility that the 6th Army could actually have been saved at Stalingrad, and that would have meant an enormous change in the fortunes of both the Russian front and, of course, the whole war. Late in the war, we continued to see the misuse of German engineering and the brilliance of the design Even with the development of jet fighters later in the war, they were still trying to turn those to a bombing role. We saw the Messerschmitt 262 and the Arado 234, both of which would have made world-class fighters, but they were actually used in this fighter-bomber role. And really that goes back to this whole business of Germany never having really developed a suitable aircraft for the roles that they were intended.
Throughout its history, the Luftwaffe laboured under restrictions that had been handed down from the Führer himself. Goering was to say, "Hitler would never ask how big our bombers are, but how many we have." This pushed the Luftwaffe into trying to get as many aircraft into the air as possible.
Without a doubt, the Luftwaffe was one of the least successful arms in Hitler's war machine. And again, without a doubt, the blame for that has to lie at the door of Hermann Göring. In the whole history of warfare, it's difficult to think of someone who held on for so long, who was so utterly inept at doing the job he was there to do.
Without the extra operational range of four-engined aircraft, Germany was deprived of the necessary weapon to strike deep into the heart of a well-defended enemy. The short and medium-ranged bombers necessary for the Blitzkrieg tactics were unable to deliver effective strategic bombing. The Luftwaffe was superbly structured and equipped to fulfill the tasks that Hitler had chosen for it. Unfortunately, it was to prove to be the wrong task. The bombers of the Luftwaffe were unable to prevent the ultimate defeat of the German war machine.